All right, everyone, welcome again. This is Paul from Inside PA Training. I have my good buddy and former classmate from when we were in PA school, Jevon, with us.
Hi.
Jevon's going to talk about his specialty today, which is?
Hospital medicine.
Hospital medicine. Inpatient medicine, also known as hospitalist.
Inpatient internal medicine.
Okay.
Yeah.
I would think, my guess is the way a lot of people are going to view this is they didn't know that that was something that PAs did. Mm-hmm. You're obviously evidence that they do. Can you say a little bit about it?
Sure. I think it is kind of new. It's definitely a newer way that PAs are being utilized, but I think it's quickly becoming widespread. Just as a hospitalist medicine in general is becoming more widespread, that's sort of a new model in medicine to have, primary care doctors not admitting their patients to the hospital anymore, mm-hmm. and having specialized doctors that just do inpatient care. So as more and more hospitals adopt that model, I think more and more groups are going to be using mid-levels, both physician assistants and nurse practitioners, in various hospitalist roles.
Uh-huh. So just for the folks who don't know, I mean, a lot of people are just totally just starting to investigate this profession. What is a hospitalist? What do they do?
So a hospitalist doctor, say, is usually an internist, an internal medicine specialist, who only takes care of you once you come into the hospital. So you go into the emergency room, you have pneumonia. The emergency room physician says, okay, I think we need to, keep you here in the hospital, give you IV antibiotics, and then the hospitalist physician will come and admit you to the hospital and write orders and put you in, and then, the hospitalist will come and see you the next day and round on you daily and then discharge you when you've progressed to that point that you can be managed as an outpatient. And then you go back under the care of your primary care provider at that point. So really a physician assistant in that hospitalist role does virtually the same kind of job that a hospitalist doctor does. But obviously it can vary a little bit from institution mm-hmm. to institution. There can be some certain restrictions on, maybe what procedures you perform, but the general kind of activities are the same.
Okay. Can you say a little bit about how much and what kind of autonomy you have versus, there people watching these videos, I think, would get the sense, accurately, as PAs, we're practicing under the supervision of a licensed physician, but what that actually looks like mm-hmm. and how that plays out really depends on the setting, and can you speak to that for your specialty?
Yeah, I mean, really, I have a lot of autonomy, almost I would say as much autonomy as I'm comfortable with, I'm able to have, as long as there's a sort of a trusting relationship with your supervising doctor, then that doctor kind of knows that if you get into a case where you're a little bit over your head, you're going to ask for help, and that they can trust you with cases that you feel you aren't over your head. So I work pretty independently.
So like how many decisions do you make during a typical day that you run by mm-hmm. a physician?
We should
throw out there that you're relatively new PA. Mm-hmm. Like you haven't been doing this for years. This is your, we graduated last June,
right.
a year ago and a couple months.
Yeah. And the first 4 or so months I was doing kind of like urgent care. So really I've only been a hospitalist for about 8 or 9 months.
Uh-huh. So how many decisions do you think?
But, I'll go through the whole process of talking with the emergency room doctor about a patient that we're going to admit and ordering some extra tests that I think I want to have before I write all the admission orders. I go see the patient. I do a history and physical on the patient. I write my orders up, what kind of fluids they're going to get, what kind of antibiotics, consults, labs, imaging. And then the patient gets admitted, and then I kind of care for that patient for the rest of the shift and take calls from the nurses on the floor if any kind of issues arise. And so typically that whole process will occur without really talking with my supervising doctor at all. And you know, if there is some kind of collaboration, then it might be, you know, maybe one question about, oh, should I start the patient on this antibiotic versus this one,
or here's where I was thinking I would go with this.
Just wanted to run this by you, and does that sound good to you? But usually it would just be a one call here or there kind of thing.
Yeah, so in other words, there's not a doctor by your side all the time. There's not a doctor approving everything you do. And I think that's important to people in joining this field. They're kind of like, you know, I don't want to be a glorified, you know, medical assistant.
Right. Yeah. No, you're very much an autonomous practitioner. But really, I mean, it's great because you've got someone who knows more than you do and has more experience than you do that you can go to when you have questions. So you're never, like, stuck. You're never in a position where you feel like, I don't know if I'm making the right call here, because if you're not comfortable, there's someone you can talk to.
So what kind of patients do you come across typically?
So I deal with a lot of patients with, lower respiratory infections, COPD exacerbation, pneumonia, lots of CHF patients.
Heart failure.
Yep, renal patients, severe, like, skin and soft tissue infections if they can't be managed on an outpatient basis.
Does your hospital see trauma patients at all?
A little bit. So sometimes I'll assist on admitting trauma patients. So one thing I don't do is take care of patients in the ICU. At least at my facility, the mid-level providers don't have ICU privileges, which at some facilities they do.
Yeah. So that would be critical care medicine.
Right.
Hospitalist work tends to be on the regular hospital floors.
Well, hospitalist doctors will often have ICU privileges and will sort of co-manage ICU patients either with intensivists or with other specialists that work in the ICU. Mm-hmm. It kind of varies from hospital to hospital.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it's somewhat common in hospitalist models that use PAs that even if the doctors on the team have ICU privileges, maybe the PAs don't so much, unless you were actually in a sort of a critical care PA position where you were working alongside the intensivists full time in the ICU.
What kinds of things do you get to do? I mean, are you allowed to do procedures, or are you?
That's one thing. Again, I think I haven't had the opportunity to do that yet, but a lot of programs do use their mid-levels to do procedures like central lines, arterial lines, intubations, paracentesis, thoracentesis. Those sorts of procedures are definitely within the scope of a physician assistant working in the inpatient setting.
Yeah, you and I chatted, and I sort of know the answer before I asked the question, but this is for everybody else's sake. You don't currently do a lot of them, but that's certainly within your reach, the kind of things that you could do as a hospitalist, depending on where you work.
Right.
What do you like about your job? What do you like about being a hospitalist?
Mm-hmm. It's fascinating medicine. I mean, the complexity of the kind of patients that I'm caring for is high, and I like that.
These are pretty sick people.
Exactly.
It's hard to get admitted to the hospital nowadays unless you're pretty sick.
Right. So
because of the cost.
Yeah. So they're different patients than you would deal with, say, in an outpatient primary care clinic.
Mm-hmm.
Some of them are similar patients, and they're just their severity of illness is greater. But I just find the pathology very interesting. I enjoy working with colleagues in nursing and medicine and physical therapy, occupational therapy, all of those kind of allied health professions that I have the opportunity to collaborate with in the hospital. I enjoy that, and I like the pace of being able to kind of really focus on one patient at a time and be real thorough and kind of have time to step back and think about what's going on, kind of look at the big picture. And
what's a typical patient load for a hospitalist shift?
So it depends. You know, what I do is I'm kind of like an admissionist, so I do a lot of admitting patients from the ER into the hospital, and then some sort of spot rounding on patients in the hospital as needed. But then another typical role that PAs will fill is where they don't admit, but they just round on patients regularly. So maybe there'd be like 12 to 15 patients that the PA would take on a shift, and they would be responsible for seeing each one of those patients once during the shift.
So they would get it handed over to them by someone like you.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay. And what about this job are you maybe not so fond of, or something about it that's not for some people? People do, I think at this stage people get curious about what kind of specialty they might be interested in.
Right. I would say maybe I miss, because I did some urgent care when I first started, I kind of miss the procedures, like getting to do suturing and that kind of thing. I don't do that at all right now in my job. So I miss that a little bit. It's pretty specific to, adult patients with kind of internal medicine type issues. So I don't do any pediatrics. I don't do any women's health. So maybe I missed that broadness a little bit that mm-hmm. was my job before when I was doing outpatient medicine.
Mm-hmm. And how does it pay as a specialty in general?
It pays well. I can't remember what the stats are exactly, but definitely, hospital medicine is one of the higher paying specialties compared to a lot of the kind of outpatient work.
Mm-hmm. Awesome.
Yeah, and the shift work can, it could be good or bad depending on whether you like that kind of thing. I do 12-hour shifts.
How many a week?
It varies a lot. Sometimes I'll do 3 shifts, sometimes I'll do 7 shifts.
Really?
Wow. You can kind of have blocks of time.
When you get off work, are you totally off? Are you on call?
Not on call.
No call. That's nice. That's nice. We're just about out of time. I did want to ask you what kind of advice you might have for someone who wants to become a PA and possibly go into the specialty. What would you tell them?
That's a good question. I would say study hard.
Yeah.
Because it's just, it's one of those specialties where you kind of have to know a lot about a lot of different stuff. I mean, you could say that about any specialty, really, but it is a broad specialty, say, compared to maybe dermatology.
Right.
I should
throw out there for folks who don't know you, which is most people watching this video, Jevon is a super studious clinical guy. You are good at the medicine, and you're very humble, but you're sharp, man. I mean, this is not a specialty for somebody who's just kind of casually interested in medicine. And you're also, you have another role we're going to talk about in another video in the future, and that is you're an NP as well.
Yeah, so. Probably your listeners probably know, and our program is a dual
I was not a nurse, so I got a PA, but
right.
most of us
who are nurses got PA and NP training.
Yeah. And that really is only specific, really, as far as I know, only found at UC Davis. So.
Right. Yeah.
Okay. Well, hey, Jevon, thank you so much for talking to us.
Hey, thank you.
Good luck with your job.
Thanks, Paul. Good luck to everyone out there.
Thanks.